right, praise God. How many of you ready for some more word? Let's go there together. Open up your Bibles to Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Mark is the second book in the New Testament, second account of Jesus' life. Let's go there together. If you ever want to read just kind of like some action-based narrative of Jesus' life, like the highlight reel, really, you can find that in Mark. You know, he just kind of jumps from one thing to the other, and you just see this amazing array of what Jesus did. And we're going to look this morning at one of Jesus' secrets of how he did what he did, because we're breaking into a whole new series that I want you to encourage you to be a part of and kind of track with us. Those of you watching by Periscope, you can do this. We're going to be talking about this every Sunday in April. And so welcome to our service today, and I hope you enjoy it. For those of you following up after on catch.me/gatewayvictory, thank you for finding us there. And you can find our whole series as we go through them. They'll be posted. How many of you think it's cool that we're in touch with the whole world right now just through one little device at the front? Anybody else think that's cool? Yeah? You think that's cool if you're sitting there watching it in your living room? Of course, I'm going to be bugging you later for why you weren't in church, isn't that right? Hope you enjoy it. We're praying for you and thinking about you wherever you are. I'm going to pray one more time if you don't mind. Father, we're just asking you this morning just to come and feed us your word. Jesus, we feel like we're coming this morning to sit at your feet. Jesus, to hear what you have to say to us. Holy Spirit, you're the only one that can do this. You can take the words of a person, you can flip them around in the air, you can make them land on every heart to be precisely what that person needed to hear. God, we're believing you for that this morning. God, for you to come and as a master builder, a master craftsman, just to weave your word into our thinking, into our thoughts, into our heart this morning. God, we're asking you for that table that we could just come and sit. You know, even as the storm for many of us worlds around us on the outside of these four walls, and our lives are what our lives are outside of here, that God, right in the presence of that, in this place, that God, you would feed us, that we'd be able to partake. Spirit of God, come and do that in us. God, that's our prayer. We ask you for it. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, here we go. You have a life. Some of you think maybe not much of a life, but you have a life. Maybe it's not a lot, but it's a life. And I want to say this morning, that you have a spiritual life. You have a life, and you have a spiritual life. Let me say it this way. You have a world that you occupy. The sphere of what you do every day, day in, day out, the family, the friends, the people, the work that constitutes that. You have a world, listen, and you have a private world. You have a life and you have a spiritual life. You have a world that you occupy, and then you have a spiritual inner world that you occupy. Let me take this a step deeper as we're thinking about this morning. You have a diet. Many of you didn't want to think about this morning, but listen. You have a diet, yeah? Like you ingest, you take in certain foods that help you sustain the energy that you need for your life, and they feed your body and help your body heal and so on and so forth. You have a diet. You know where I'm going, don't you? But you also have a spiritual diet. In a world so full of all the distractions and the noise, if you want to put it that way, it's easy for us to get so focused on the wrong things or just the plethora of things that we forget to feed in our lives that which matters most. The inner world. The private world. The spiritual life. The diet that feeds the part of us that connects with God. We're going to be looking at this a little bit. We're going to dig down into some best ways to do this. We're going to challenge one another. I'm going to give you a challenge before we're done here this morning. We're going to challenge one another to take this further than we've ever taken it before in our spiritual lives. I've talked to some of you, and I know that, I've talked to some of you, and I know that you pray for hours every day. I was talking to you. I don't. I can't. I have young kids, you know. So please pray for me while you're doing that. And, you know, I know some people that pray for hours every day. I just talked to somebody the other day that said, yeah, no, I'm reading through the Bible in 90 days. Have you ever heard of this program? I'm reading through the Bible in 90 days. All you have to do is read 15 chapters a day. Good for you. You know, good for you. I don't know when I'm going to do that. I mean, there's a few shows I really need to catch every night, and I'm not sure I could really squeeze that in. You know, the commercials aren't that long, you know. But, yeah, so many of us, I say that to say this, many of us, when it comes to feeding the part of our lives that matters most, our spiritual lives, many of us are in all kinds of different places with this. And I don't say any of this morning to kind of point out a lack or a negative or a thumbs down in your life at all. In fact, I point out this morning some things from the Word of God to say about potential, about where we could go, about what God could do if we gave Him the ability, if we decided to receive from Him the essential nutrients that we needed for our lives. And so we're going to look at this a little bit about our spiritual life, our inner world, our spiritual diet. What we're going to unpack, and you might want to track with this over the next few weeks, but what we're going to unpack are the essential ingredients that we need to grow our relationship with God. You've heard about vitamin programs, right? Have you ever kind of sent away money every month and received the vitamins every month? Or, you know, you go to the pharmacy section or the health food section of the grocery store and you got to pick up your vitamins, right? Because you know you need this vitamin and this vitamin and this vitamin. You need these essential nutrients, you know, and you're not convinced that your diet of McDonald's is giving you the essential nutrients, and so you have to supplement. Right, okay. We're going to talk about, not on the physical diet, but on the spiritual diet, what would be those essential nutrients that we need? And just to really simplify and say, okay, God, where are we at with that? And we're going to challenge each other in the process as we go. We're going to grow and we're going to nurture the part of our lives that matters most. Because it's this inner world, it's this spiritual life that matters more than anything else. And yet if we're not careful with the distractions and the hustle and the bustle of our lives, we'll neglect it. I mean, it kind of goes without saying. We don't drift to a place of feeding that. We drift to a place of neglect. And I think that you'd probably all agree that that's right. I want to make something clear. I started 2013, I think it was, working out at a brand new gym by my house. Started working out there, and whenever I could, I'd go running because I like to go running. In fact, the more I go running during the week, the better my messages are. I'd go outside and I'd run around the Glenmore Reservoir or whatever, and the more that I'd run, the ideas would come to me and some of the illustrations, and the more that I would run, the better my messages were. It's really quite something. And then ever since I started going to the gym and running on the treadmill, the more I would run, the more repetitive my messages were. I said that before. I think you're sorry about that. But anyway, at the gym, you know, the treadmill that I like to run on, I get on it and I run on it. And at this particular gym, it's kind of like a low-cost kind of gym. And you know, they're trying to get people that wouldn't necessarily be a part of the gym to be a part of the gym, you know, and maybe that's why I signed up, you know, make the price point right. And up on the walls are these big letters. And the letters say this: no judgment. You know, tell people like you and me feel good about being there. You know, there's no judgment in here. I don't know how they can accomplish that with words on a wall, but you know what? I was bummed out one time and decided to go running at the gym, and so I'm running at the gym and I got bumped off my treadmill by, you know, somebody else that was working out ahead of me, and so I had to go to a couple of treadmills down, and I'm there on the treadmill and I'm running, and you know, they have TV screens for you to watch different things, and because this particular TV screen was right in my line of view of the word no. So as I was running on the treadmill, all I could see in big letters across the back wall was judgment. And I was like, you know, I really don't need this right now. You know, like, God, where are you in this? I'm telling you, you know, with all the distractions and the TVs and the things that are on the screen of our lives, you know, this whole area of feeding our spiritual lives, that receiving the essential nutrients that we need for growing our relationship with God, it's easy for us to feel the judgment, isn't that right? Because of all the distractions. It's easy for us to feel kind of, I don't read the Bible enough, and I don't pray enough, and I don't go to church enough, and we kind of feel lower and lower and lower about ourselves. And here's where it goes. If God was going to use somebody, He would use the next person. If God really wanted to move on somebody's life or provide them something outside of their expectation, it would probably be the person that prayed more, or read their Bible more, or went to church more faithfully. Isn't that right? I mean, that's where it goes. The judgment thing kind of pushes us lower and lower and lower until we really don't want to hear about it. Isn't that right? It's like, I'd just rather not go to the gym than go to the gym and just see judgment. I'd rather not sit down and open my Bible if all I feel when I sit down and open my Bible is, God, when was the last time I did this? Yeah. I don't know where to start. Right. I'd rather not go to church. As soon as I go to church, I just kind of feel, hey, I have to talk to you about something. I was talking to one of our visitors lately, and they said that when they go to they haven't been to our kind of church ever before, and they said that when they go to the kind of church that they used to go to, they say, you know, like, when I go to that church, you know, like, I feel like I'm going to burn. When I come here, I kind of feel good. I think that's good, right, Jesus? That's good, right? Yeah, no, it's good. It is good. You know why? Because there's not judgment written on the wall of what we're talking about and of our message. Come on. Right? It's who we can be when God gets a hold of us. When we begin to feed the essential, give ourselves the essential nutrients, feed the part of us that matters the most, it's who we can be and who we can become and what God has for us. Listen. Hear me out, church, please. God never uses condemnation. He never makes you feel smaller and smaller and smaller. He never uses judgment. He never uses you should have and why didn't you and now look. Are you hearing me this morning? The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, therefore, because of what Jesus has done, there is no condemnation for you and for me, for we are in Christ Jesus. Oh, praise God. You know what God does? It's the enemy that makes you feel lower and lower. You know what God does? He lifts you up higher and higher. Look what you can do. Look what you can become. Look what would happen if you, hey, I've got a better way than you. That's what he's like. Praise God. So I want us to think for a little while. I want us to give it some attention. I want us to think about our inner world, about the stuff that feeds that private inner world, that place that you and I live from all the time. I'm going to take you to Mark chapter 1, and we're going to go to verse 35. Mark chapter 1, 35. And it says this, now in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, this is the New King James Version, and some of your other versions say, before dawn, or, you know, he got up early in the morning, and this is talking about Jesus, and it says, now early in the morning, having risen a long while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place. He is Jesus. He went out, departed to a solitary place. Some of your Bibles might say desolate or alone place. And there he prayed. Capital H, he, Jesus. There he prayed. Flurry of activity going on around him. We'll see here in a moment that what Jesus was facing was a lot of people that needed him. You know, it kind of sounds like us, right? Like a lot of people that need us and places to go and things to do. And it says, very early in the morning, Jesus got up. He departed, he went away, he separated himself, he went to a lonely place, a desolate place, and there Jesus prayed. Folks, this verse in Mark has haunted me my entire Christian life. I can hear my dad preaching on this, you know, I'm a son of a Baptist preacher, and I can hear him in my mind, even while I'm going through it, I can hear him preaching this, because here's the point. If Jesus did it, took time to feed the part of him that mattered most. If he found it necessary to do this, find a way to figure out a system to put this in his spiritual diet. If Jesus had to do it, where does that leave you and me? Come on now. That's the main point here. This is why it's embedded in Scripture. In the flurry of activity and the masses of humanity pressing in on him. Mark 1:35, very early in the morning, Jesus got up before the break of day, went to a solitary place, and there he shut himself in with the Father, and he prayed. He took some time to feed the part of him that matters most. I'm not saying it has to be pre-dawn. I'm not saying you have to leave your house and jump in your car or take your quad off into the mountains somewhere and there you need to pray. I'm not saying that. I'm saying finding a way and finding a place and finding a time that you can do this, that you can feed the part of you that matters most, the essential nutrients that will grow your spiritual life. Watch this for a moment. Verse 36. And Simon and those who were with him searched for him. Jesus got away and escaped the crowds. And then they were searching for him. And when he found him, they said to him, almost incredulous, "Master, everyone is looking for you. Like, what are you doing here? We've got a ministry to run. We've got people to serve. We've got jobs to do. We've got this thing that you've started to finish. Like, what are you doing here?" And that they're incredulous. Like, "Master, everyone is searching for you." Verse 37. When they found him, they said, "Everyone is searching for you." Verse 38. But he said to them, watch this, "Let us go into the next towns." While he was with the Father, feeding the part of him that mattered most, the spiritual, his inner world, while he was with the Father, he received a vision and a direction and an impulse, an impetus on the inside of him that took him contrary to the crowds, to the good things that he was doing. It took him in a different direction to the within the momentum that he was already caught up in. You hearing me this morning? It was while he was with the Father, separated, alone, by himself, with God, that he found himself being pulled in a different direction than the crowds and the people than the world that was around him. He said to them, "Let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, because for this purpose I have come forth." Encapsulate this for you. While he was with the Father, the purpose that he had come forth to accomplish was able to surface from all the other noise and the voices and the "Master, what are you doing? Everyone is waiting for..." It enabled the purpose to surface in his heart where he began to know what it is that he was meant to do and what the next step was in it. With certainty. So he could say to the crowds, "No, that's nice. I know you need me, but I'm moving on to the next place. I'm moving on to the next crowd." Think about this with me. How many of us need that? There's crowds, there's distraction, there's noise, there's kids, there's friends, there's people, there's husbands, there's wives, there's, well, maybe only one each, but they're all around, you know, they're trying to pull us in all these different directions. There's things at work, there's projects, there's taxes, there's elections in the United States. My God, what's going to happen? You know, there's all this stuff going on. Come on, isn't that right? How many of you would love, would cherish the ability to shut all that down like a power switch, like, "Okay, God, what next? What is the purpose that I'm here? That I'm married to that person? That I'm in this place of work? That I'm in this friendship? What is the purpose that I'm here in this church, in this community? God, what is my purpose? Let it surface. All right? Okay, I got it. And now here's what I need to do." How many of you would relish that opportunity? Listen, it's not just for Jesus. It's for you and me. In our lives down here on the earth, to have this inner world, this inner space. The Bible in some places talks about it as the secret place. The place, the source of power and source of strength that you can be so aware of. I don't know if you're aware of this about your own psychology, but you know, psychologists will tell you this, and here's what they'll tell you. You know, what you focus on will grow. And it will grow to monopolize your thoughts about anything else. What you focus on. It can be a relationship. It can be a problem. It can be an aspect of the media or the news that you keep on hearing about. I mean, you could pick, test it. Pick any one area, any one thing, or any one person and begin to obsess about it. Yeah? Begin to, like, focus on it. And what you focus on, instead of this, "I'm going to deal with that someday. You know, I'm going to deal with that someday." When you focus on it, it begins to grow, 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 grow. You ever done that with a worry or a fear? To the point when you wake up in the morning, that's the first thing that's right there. It's like this big thing. You ever done that? Fear is like that, isn't it? Or worry or a concern or a stress, what you focus on begins to grow. How many of you would love, would cherish the opportunity to say, "Okay, in my life, I need to focus on what God is saying to me. about what my purpose is down here on the earth, about how, what God wants me to do with these kids and in this family, about where this job thing is going, where this work's going, what God wants me to do here in this city, to focus on that to the point, and on his voice to the point where that's all you think about, that's all you know, that's where you live. How many of you want that? So it's not just a stand up in church sometime and you're singing along and you're like, oh, that feels so good to be back in church. Not like that, but like all the time. Where you live there. Don't know about you, but that's me. I want to take you to another scripture this morning. Proverbs chapter 25. Sorry, Proverbs 20, chapter 24. Proverbs chapter 24. You can go there with me if you like, or I can just read this to you. You know, some scriptures you want to say amen after you read them. Other scriptures you want to say, oh me, you know, after you read them, it's like, oh, whoa, where do I measure up with what this is saying here? All right, this is one of the old me passages. All right, give you a heads up. How's that? Okay, ready? Proverbs chapter 24, verse 30. I went by the field of the lazy man, and by the vineyard of the man who is devoid of understanding. Proverbs is like this, all right? Just give me a second. Proverbs is like this. It'll take you on this little journey, on this little kind of narrative or whatever, to teach you a lesson, to show you something about yourself or about human nature. This passage does it really well. I went by the field of the lazy man, and by the vineyard of the man devoid of understanding. Oh, sorry, another caveat. I'm not calling anybody here lazy or stupid. All right, this is not the point of the scripture. The point of the scripture is to open it up and to see something about what God's saying about our inner world. Are you here? All right, here we go. I went by the field of the lazy man, and by the vineyard of the man devoid of understanding. Some of you are thinking, if that's not what he's saying, why does he keep repeating that verse? Okay, one more time. I went by the field of the lazy man, and by the vineyard of the man devoid of understanding, and there it was, all overgrown with thorns. Its surface was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. And when I saw it, I considered it well. I looked on it, and I received instruction. This is the point. I looked on it, and I received instruction. I considered it well. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. So shall your poverty come like a prowler, and your need like an armed. Well, I hope you're all blessed this morning. Let's all stand up and pray. Praise God. Sobering scripture. You can apply this to different areas of life, but I want us to apply it to our inner world, our private world. And I want us to apply it this way. That your inner world, your heart, not the world you live out there that I know about or your friends know about, but your inner world, the place you connect with God. Your inner world can be a place of vibrancy and color and health and peace and joy. The Bible says that you would be in health. This is the wish of the Father, the hope of the Father, that you would be in health and prosper. The Bible says, even as your soul prospers. Isn't that right? Your inner world can be a place of vibrancy and beauty and a place, a source of life for you and for other people. No matter, regardless of your circumstances that are around you, no matter what they're like, no matter what, you can have that on the inside. Or your inner world can be a place where the walls are broken down, where the enemy has come in to kill and to steal and destroy, where instead of faith, there's fear. Where instead of a revelation of the love of the Father, there's all kinds of worry and stress and anger. Where you've begun to take on ideas and thoughts and you've let stuff grow there that aren't from God and you haven't weeded them out. Come on, we've all kind of drifted there, isn't that right? We've all had places and areas where the enemy has kind of broken in and done some damage. But the vision of where we're going is a place where you and I dwell. Our inner world, where we connect with God, and we can feed it the essential nutrients that it needs for us to move ahead. I want to say this morning. It pays to pay attention to these things. We're going to get down to some where the rubber meets the road. I've got a challenge here for you in a few minutes. But I want to preface it by saying this. It pays to pay attention to these things, to take our eyes off of the stuff that's around us, to look in the scriptures, to look about how to do this. It pays to pay attention to your spiritual life. And I'm going to challenge you to try it here in a few moments. Here's why. You pay a little bit of attention to your spiritual life, your inner world, and it will reap huge rewards. Huge rewards in your world. You pay attention to your inner world, you will reap the benefits in your outer world. Almost same day. Almost like the next 5 minutes. It's true. The way that you feel about yourself, the things that you say, the people around you will notice a difference in you. Just a little bit of attention there. We're not talking about shave off half your day and try and spend it with God. We're not talking about that. We're talking just a little bit of attention goes a long way. That's a great reason to pay attention. It pays to pay attention to your spiritual life. Another reason why it pays to pay attention is this, and we've already kind of touched on it, is that what's happening here on the inside of you, where you connect with God, it is the source. The Bible says this in Proverbs 3. It is the source of the rest of what's going on in your life. It is the source of life. I mean, there's other people with their sources and their inner worlds and their states all around you as well. But by and large, the life that we're living is an outplay of this blueprint that's in here. Are you aware of that? Jesus said it. He talked about how your life flows from your heart and from the things that you say, that this is all coming from somewhere. Have you ever kind of rubbed shoulders with somebody or kind of hurt somebody, rebuke somebody, you're kind of get angry or whatever, you're like, man, they must be hurting. Do you ever think that? Kind of like, where are they coming from that would do that? That would make them do that? Like where are they coming from? You know, because we understand this intuitively, that what's on the inside manifests on the outside and it creates a life around us. So listen, it pays to pay attention to these things because what's inside does come out. Be aware of that. We leak. Yeah. There's fear, anxiety, animosity, unforgiveness, all kinds of vile things that can happen in the heart of a person. When that's there, it leaks, right? I mean, we fool ourselves when no one will know and no one cares and I'm just going to go ahead, I'm just going to be the dad or be the mom or be the friend or be their coworker, and nobody's really going to know. No, people know. It leaks. It comes out. What's inside comes out. So listen, to feed yourself the essential nutrients, what matters most, it pays huge dividends in the way that you live your life, your quality of life. You will never regret time that you spend here. Amen. Here's another reason. Say, well, you know, your focus here has tremendous benefits. What's happening here is the source of everything else that's going on. Let me talk to you as a pastor or spiritual leader here for a moment. When it comes down to it, here's another reason why it pays to pay attention to your spiritual life. No one else will do it for you. No one else is going to make you sit down and read your Bible, pray, get to church, feed yourself those relationships that you know are going to feed you spiritually. No one's going to do that for you. Isn't that true? I mean, it's really true, isn't it? So listen, who's going to disciple you in this area? No one's going to do it for you. That's why it pays attention. It pays to pay attention to this area because nobody's going to sit you down and make you do it. Have you ever been a spouse? Have you been married to someone that tried to make you spend your time with God? Now, honey, let's get out our Bibles. We're going to pray now, okay? No, doesn't work, does it? Doesn't work. In the closest of human relationships. Why? It is unique to you. It needs to be from your heart to the heart of the Father. No one can do this for you. No one can pave this road for you. You will reach the end of your life and you will be someone that knows God and walks with God. Or you will be someone that's like, I've never quite understood God, but I hope I'm going somewhere good. Like, and the difference between those two will be what you did on the journey, the day in, the day out, that no one's going to do for you in feeding the part of you that matters. A little focus here has tremendous benefits. What's happening here is the source of everything else that's going on. No one's going to do this for you. Do it for you. Do it for your spouse. Do it for your kids. Do it for your future spouse. Because no one's going to do it for you. I want to say this, just as a final reason, this is why it pays to pay attention here. This is about your impact on the world. It's about God's influence on the world through you. That's what this is about. Follow me. You encountering God and being sensing his presence. And you know, much of that has to be with, you know, do with being in the right place at the right time. Being in the right church at the right time, and you sense God and you feel God and you embrace him, and there's this encounter and he changes your life, right? I mean, much of your own God encounter, your life-changing God encounter, comes from being in the right place at the right time. And you can do things in your routine that will help you with that, be in the right place at the right time. But really, it's that. It's being in the right place at the right time. Listen, other people's life-changing God encounter, and we talk about that a lot at this church, other people's encountering God depends more on your consistency with what you feed yourself spiritually than right time, right place. Did you catch that? I mean, your encounter with God, right place, right time, you feel God, you sense God, you encounter him. Other people's, it's going to be because you are a person that constantly feeds the spiritual reservoir of your life, the source of the rest of your life. This is about your impact on other people. And so we're going to go there. Vitamins, anyone? Let me take a few more minutes. Here are the essential nutrients. I've already stated them, and right from the start of the series, we're just going to lay them out. And then we're going to issue a challenge. Here are the essential nutrients. You know, really, if you boil it all down, all the different books and things you can read, all the things that the Bible says about how to grow your spiritual life, really it comes down to three very, very basic and simple things. You can think of this like the three-legged stool of Christianity. All right, the three-legged stool of Christianity. It's hard to stay stable on a stool if you're sitting on a stool with only one leg. Right? Two legs, maybe a little easier, still kind of. You put three legs on a stool, you've got some stability. You can sit there and have a chat, have a beer. Isn't that right? Okay, so the three-legged stool of Christianity. These are the three essential nutrients. Real quick, I'm going to give them to you straight off the top. Number one is this. If you're writing them down, write it this way. A personal prayer connection with God. You knew I was going to say prayer, didn't you? Check this out. A personal, not based on somebody else's praying, not just when you're around other people that happen to be praying, but your personal prayer connection with God. Many of you know that I'm a BlackBerry fan. Sorry, all you iPhone people. iPhones are such a fad, you know? Anyway, so BlackBerry, I don't know why, but they decided to open up their platform to the Android OS. I'm not sure why they would do that. They had a perfectly good platform by themselves. Great Canadian company. Anyway, so they open up their platform. So they have kind of like a hybrid phone, if you want to say it that way, where it's kind of like BlackBerry messaging and calendar and so forth. And then the rest of the phone is like, it's like Android. How many of the Android users do we have? Android, BlackBerry, kind of friends. I think they all shake hands at the top, you know. I'm sure Donald Trump has the same phone as I do. And so, praise God. On the Android platform, we have users in the house, you know. On the Android platform, you know, you just kind of like scoop up from the bottom and it opens up your Google page, right? And you've got these cards there as weather and news and all that kind of stuff, right? And you can do this. You can say, okay, Google. And then your phone goes bloop. And then there's like three little dots. And then it says, listening, right? And then you can say anything like, can you go get me a coffee, you know, or, you know. I've heard that iPhone has something named Siri or something like that. Doesn't compete at all. But anyway, so when you go to Google, you can just kind of like scoop up whatever, just like, okay, Google, listening. Okay. I don't mean to bring Jesus down to the level of Google, but a personal prayer connection with God is like 5 bazillion times better than, okay, Jesus, listening. What am I supposed to do now? You hear me? Okay, Jesus. Can you make it not rain? Okay, Jesus. How many times in your life have you, you know, we were sitting around the other day at a family function, you know, birthday party, and something came up that we didn't really know. I think it was like media related or news related, but something came up that we didn't really know. And like within like 15 seconds of, oh, I wonder what, you know, whatever some thing was or whatever, within 15 seconds or whatever, like 3 or 4 phones were out around the room and people were Googling it and checking it out, right? I mean, it's a different world we live in, isn't it, right? Instant information wherever you need it. This is 5 bazillion times better than that, where you're like, okay, Jesus, he's listening to your every care, every concern, everything that you would ever need. He's listening. a personal prayer connection with God, that it's open for business, it's open for communication, every moment of every day of our lives. That's the way that it's meant to be. A personal prayer connection with God. Prayer is that you're supposed to be able to walk with God and pray with Him at the drop of a hat at any moment during the day. Your praying could be like, okay, Jesus, so what about this? You're walking into the office at work and it's going to be about, you think you know what it's going to be about, and you have to sit down and just kind of face some questions or whatever, and you could be, okay, Jesus. He's there with you, yeah? He's there to help you, to whisper in your ear. A personal dialogue with Jesus, a personal prayer connection with God. This is the first essential nutrient that you and I need to feed the part of us that matters most. But I'll give you a little preview into things. Prayer. There needs to be two kinds of prayer. One kind of prayer is the prayer where you're doing business with God. It's business prayer. Where you're like, okay, God, I'm going to pray for this person at work because, man, they need it, and I don't think they're doing any praying. God, I'm going to pray for this city because I really feel that God wants to do something in the city or in my church. And it's like you're taking hold together with God over something, and you're praying and you're praying and you're praying. You're doing work in the Spirit. You ever experienced that? Where you're like praying for something maybe in your own life, and you're kind of working with God, praying over something. We're going to get into how to do that. But then there's, and some of us kind of live there, but there's a whole other realm of prayer, which is just relationship prayer. Which is you just walking with God, like, God, you're so awesome. And He's like, yeah, I know you're awesome too. And you're like, no, that's because you made me awesome. Yeah, He's like, no, but you're living an awesome life. And you kind of go back and forth, you know, like, God, you're awesome, no, you're awesome. God, I love you, no, you know, I love you. And you explore the whole depth of relationship. Come on. It's like a married couple living together. What kind of married couple would it be if it was always all about the work that needed to be done, the chores, the garbage, the laundry, the kids, the diapers, the yard? Like, what kind of relationship would that be if they didn't unhook from all that, that I'm sure they enjoy doing together, unhook from all that to, hey, it's just you and me. Just you and me. Isn't that right? Prayer, a personal connection, prayer connection with God. Number one, nutrient. Number two, God wants to take us somewhere with this. I know this in my heart. Number two is a unique interaction with the Word of God. A unique interaction. Unique to you. Not my interaction with the Word of God. Not you eating just kind of what I'm feeding, or what person that you listen to online feeds you, or messages that you listen to, but your own unique harvesting of what this book says for your life. It's an essential nutrient for your spiritual journey to grow the thing that matters the most. And it'll pay to pay attention to this. A unique interaction with His Word. Here's what this means. At any time, day or night, I or one of your friends could sit down with you and say, so what's God speaking to you from the Bible? And you'd be like, oh, the other day, I was reading this song, and the verse that jumped out at me was this. I think that God means this by that. And the other person's like, wow, how do you get that from that? And you're like, I don't know, but God's really speaking to me. And on it goes. Like that. A unique connection with the Bible. I don't know, have you ever felt like so in love with this book? Have you ever felt that? Where you just kind of like wanted to carry it everywhere? In our business, because my wife and I, we were in a business as well at the same time. Sometimes I'll just be walking out the door, you know, and I'll see my Bible kind of sitting there or whatever from the morning, or sitting up, you know, from Sunday on the piano or whatever, and I'll grab it on my way out the door, and I'll just kind of have it with me, because there's this unique interaction with this book. And whether you do it online or whether you've got like an actual paper copy, they come in paper copies. Have you seen these? You know, however you do it, to get some of that Word in you. Have you ever just wanted to memorize just a bunch of it? Not because you had to or someone challenged you, but just, I want that Word in me. Have you ever done that where it begins to feed you? It becomes life to you. Oh, the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. And He makes me lie down in green pastures. He restores my soul. Have you, like, words that just, His divine power has given us everything that we need for life and godliness. Listen, you can hear it preached 1,000 times, but when you get it from the Word of God for you, because you woke up early one morning and you're like, God, speak to me something, and you cracked open the Word, and it says, He who is faithful, He will do it. And you're like, oh, that's for me. That's for me. A unique interaction with the Word of God. This is what the psalmist David meant when he said, oh, I love your Word, oh God. I love your law, oh God. a unique interaction. This is where it's going for you. You become so addicted to this, you would rather flip this open and read it than mess around on Google for a while trying to find some news or something that you're interested in. Okay, you would rather spend half an hour like this than Netflixing something. Come on. Why? Well, you focus on it, grow. And then that grows you into the person that you're becoming before God. Oh, the potential. I know he wants to do something with us in this. And listen, the third essential ingredient. There's prayer. There's a connection and interaction with his word. And I'm going to just give you the third vital ingredient. And maybe you're way ahead of me, I don't know. But I want to just take a minute to say this. We need in our lives a sphere of life-giving relationships with people who pray and read the word. Are you here? We need this as an essential part of what grows the part of us that matters most. We need a sphere of relationships. A sphere of life-giving relationships with people who do the same. Which is church. Which is something midweek that you meet up with different families or different people to say, you know what, let's talk about what God's speaking to us. Let's kind of put some of this into action. Let's hold each other accountable. Yeah? Prayer, word, relationship with people that we're doing the same thing. All right. The point is not that you do these things. The point is that you do it in a way that feeds the part of you that matters most. It's not just the rote action of doing it. It's doing it in a way that feeds that part of you. Here's your challenge this morning. We're going to unpack this further. I'm going to try and be as practical as I can and just kind of open up my own sort of private life to say, you know, here's how I do these things and here's how I've grown in them. Hopefully that'll bless you over the next few weeks. But here's your challenge today before we're done. The challenge is this. To wake up 15 minutes before what you regularly wake up to. If you're one of those people that just kind of has the luxury of, you know what, I just sleep in until the kids wake me up, or I just sleep in until when I wake up, or whatever, then pick that time, or pick a time that is reasonable, and set it. Okay, 15 minutes. 15, just 15. This is my challenge to you. I'm going to see how many of you take me up on this. Set your alarm, three alarms if you have to, scattered in different places of your room. 15 minutes. Okay. If you had a friend that called you this afternoon and that friend said, listen, I know you got to get to work for 8 o'clock in the morning and I know that you're up at 7 in order to get there, but listen, I really need you for a moment. I just need you tomorrow morning. Is there any way that you could meet me somewhere at 6:30? Just meet me for coffee. I'm telling you, I just really need this from you. Who wouldn't do that? Okay. who wouldn't do that? Would do that for a friend, wouldn't you? Some of you are like, no way. Who are you? We'd do that for a friend. Jesus isn't desperate. Listen, you're the one that's desperate. Let's do this for him. 15 minutes, set that time back. And here's what I want you to do that 15 minutes, okay? The alarm's gone off, you're lying in bed. Here's what I want you to do for 15 minutes. I want you to think about what you would do if you were going to be serious about feeding the part of you that matters most. What would that look like for you? I want you to think about it. Pray about it. For 15 minutes. Set the alarm. Most of us, here's what we would have to do. Get out of bed, make a coffee, sit on the couch. 15 minutes earlier. And for those 15 minutes, think about this. If I was really going to take this seriously, what would I do? Here's the trick. By doing that, you are taking it seriously. And by doing that, you're opening up the door for God to say, this is your strategy. This is your divine time. This will switch it up for you. This will break you out of the stagnancy of your relationship with me, is what God will say. You'll find him there. And I believe if we're all doing this together in the prayers of us midweek as we're praying over the church, you know, many of us praying over the church, I believe that this will be like, it'll be like a current that you'll be drawn into to really begin to see some vibrancy on that inner part of your spiritual life. How many of you are with me in that? Do you think you could do that? Do you think you could do that? Do you think you challenge each other to do that 15 minutes? and sit there for 15 minutes and say, if I was going to take this seriously, what would I do? What do I need to change? Think of it this way. Developing a sphere of relationships around you. What would I do to be really serious about this thing called church? Does my walk in, walk out on Sunday cut it? Or is there something midweek that I need to do? That I need to clear a schedule, cancel a hockey game, do something different? Is there something that I need to do to get with the people of God so that feeds me more than what I've been doing, right? Like, what would I do if I was going to be serious about it? About the Bible, what would I do? Would I read a proverb today? Like, what would I do? Just flip around in there, and what would I do? And I believe God's going to begin to speak. He's beginning to answer us. God, this prayer thing. I never understood prayer. People would hear your voice all the time. God, I've never understood it. Maybe you're one of those people that say that. You could be one of the people, you know, God, show me how that works. God, show me how to pray. Are you speaking to me? Sit there for 15 minutes while the caffeine begins to take hold and think to yourself, what could this mean? Who could I become if I begin to feed that part of me that matters most? I'm telling you, you'll be full of purpose and you'll know what to do next. Amen. That's what I have for you this morning. I believe you know that that's from the heart of the Lord for us as a church as we begin to feed that part of ourselves. Why don't we stand up and we're going to pray together before we finish this morning. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Praise your name, Lord Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Go ahead and lock yourself in with God for a minute. You know, there's been times, you know, we've found that the most powerful part of the service is this part right here. You know, where, you know, if you're watching on Periscope, maybe you're just at home or whatever. If you're here, it's just a moment, you know, we've sung our songs and we've heard some things from the Bible. Now it's your time just to kind of stand before God. So let's just go ahead and do that. God, I thank you that you're here by your Spirit. God, thank you that your presence is real. God, thank you that your truth speaks. Father, as you begin to stir this up on the inside of us, God, I pray that you'll begin to show us how to make this happen. All across this room, out throughout online, Father, I pray that you begin to show us again how to make this happen for ourselves, for our families. God, show us how to make this happen. God, I pray that you would awaken us to the potential that's there. Father, I just pray over the spiritual lives of our people, over the people in this church this morning, over the people in our fellowship, in our church family. God, I pray out over our spiritual lives, and I rebuke stagnancy in Jesus' name, and I rebuke a way in which we've been held back from spiritual things. I rebuke distractions in Jesus' name. I rebuke them in the name of Jesus. And Father, I thank you for a clear sky. God, I thank you for an open heaven over us as we begin to contemplate more than ever before. God, how can we switch things up in our lives to be able to feed this part of us that matters most? God, come by your Spirit. Come with a divine quickening and a divine understanding. God, come with a grace like a wind that's behind us. God, for men to begin to lead spiritually in their homes. Father, for kids and for teenagers and for young adults to be able to take it upon themselves to have that connection with you. Father, for all of us, by your Spirit, God, I'm asking you to, God, come take hold together with us on this in Jesus' name, that we might know our purpose, that we might know what to do next. Father, I thank you for it. God, I thank you for speaking clearly this morning. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Did you receive that this morning? Did you receive that? Did you receive that? Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Anything else, God? Jesus' mighty name. feel free to come on up and we'll pray with you. Other than that, we dismiss you this morning. Abby and Buki, can I get you guys to come on up? I do want to pray with you. Make sure I do that. The rest of you can be dismissed. Reminder, there's birthday cake to share, and so we want that for sure. Bless the rest of your day.